get started here. Welcome to call it the marriage class. It's a marriage class, but it's from a different perspective. Name of our marriage class is What's Love Got to Do With It? And we really went through that last. If you weren't here for the last class or the class before that, you would understand what love got to do with it. You wouldn't understand. But we're going to kind of go through a review today. I don't see anybody new except.
Except who?
Oh, okay.
That young lady over there. You
know, oh, yeah.
Oh, I love that young part.
But just for the sake of being new, you want to stand up and introduce yourself and this young lady?
Oh, do I have to stand?
No, you don't have to.
Everybody, you know, I think everybody knows I'm Margot Taylor. I'm the Donaldson's cousin, little sister, whatever. God bless the titles.
Yes, Margot. We'll go through a kind of review and get you a little bit on board of okay. The class, because this class is going to go a little further. This class is going to take, the last two classes was kind of giving you a biblical foundation of what marriage was all about. Mm-hmm. This class is going to take that biblical foundation, and we're going to take it into relationships. Mm-hmm. So everything is going to, same concept, same titles, love, covenant, and marriage. But we're going to take it into relationships, biblical relationships. What do those relationships really mean? Let me hand this out while I'm talking about that, and then we get into prayer and get going. This is kind of, and it looks like it's a little redundant, but it's redundant for a reason. Because redundancy has a tendency to teach you. Redundancy also has a tendency to get that which is in your head into your heart. The Bible has a name for that. They call it meditation. That's what meditation is all about. It's a form of redundancy. Keep you mumbling over in your head, keep you mumbling over with your mouth. And to get it into your heart. Unfortunately, because of the society we live in right now, a lot of my first one. Because the society we live in right now, there's a lot of things that's got into our head and our hearts that has nothing to do with the actual original. The original is kind of a misnomer, but the intent of marriage, whether it's the original or not, it never changes. God never changes. It's the same thing then as it was now. So we got all these different concepts and precepts and ideas and expectations that deal with marriage that has nothing to deal with marriage. It has us stepping into areas we have no business stepping into. It has us putting our hearts into things we have no business putting our heart into. So we end up being hurt and misguided and misdirected and doing things for all the wrong reasons. Everybody say amen?
Amen.
So let's kind of pray and we're going to get started and get involved with today. Might be a little shorter class, because all we're going to do today is kind of do a review. And we're going to get that review down in terms of marriage, love, and covenant. And we're going to go through it so those newer people can kind of understand. So you that have been here before, guess what you're going to do? You're going to teach the newer people. You're going to teach those through the review that hasn't been here. So let's bow our heads and we'll say a little prayer and get started. Dear Heavenly Father, in the name of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, I just thank you for all those that has come here today. I thank you for those who have wanted to be here today, Father God. But I'm just asking you, Father God, to open up the eyes of those that are here, open up their ears that may hear, and their eyes that may see, and their heart that may receive all that you have for them in this class, Father God. Make my mouth like a ready pen, speaking that which you want me to speak, Father God, that this may be spirit-filled and may directed by your Holy Spirit, that we may give you all the praise and glory. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Let us say amen.
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 Y'all a little quiet today, so we're going to pick it up a little bit. I can sense the everybody's a little somber. I guess it's the weather.
It's the weather.
It's the weather. You know, I feel it. I'm sensitive to all that, so I'm not going to try to force it. And this, I guess this, the atmosphere and the spirit now. If the Holy Spirit tell me to step it up, and y'all don't want to follow, I'm sorry, I'm going to have to dance all over by myself. I have no problem doing that. But I want you to understand one thing. If you see me dancing, and you think it's a show, it's because you're looking around and not getting involved. So if you want the show, you look around. But if you want to get involved and be led by the Holy Spirit, you're going to join in. Marriage. What's love got to do with it? We started that off, and last time, I tell you, previous years before I got involved with teaching you here, I had this thing all turned all the way the other way. I would teach about love first, covenant first, then we got married. But Lord led me these last two classes to turn it around the other way. So we taught about marriage first, and we went through a few things to derive a definition of marriage. Can anybody tell me what that definition was that was here before?
Yes.
Go ahead.
A male and female coming together to reflect the image of God.
Day.
Likeness.
Image and likeness of God. Male and female coming together to reflect the image and likeness of God. How did we come up with that? Since this is supposed to be a biblical thing, this is not about my own idea, something I just conceived and I can get egotistical about and say, I thought this, so, you know. How did I come up about that? What did the Lord show me? Let's turn to Matthew 9:3. But there's actually a directive that told us what it's all about. Oh, let me stand still. There's actually a directive that tells us this. And how many know when something's put in the Bible twice, it's important. When it's put in the Bible three times, in the same concept, it's very, very, very important. Just like Jesus said, very verily, I say unto you. That means it's very important. Matthew 19:3. We're going to start right there. Do I have a reader? Or shall I get mine? Everybody there?
The Pharisees also came unto him, tempting him, and saying unto him, is it lawful for a man to put away his wife for every cause? Want me to continue?
Yeah, go ahead. Let's read the whole thing.
And he answered and said unto them, have ye not read that which that he which made them at the beginning made them male and female, and said, for this cause shall a man leave father and mother, and shall cleave to his wife, and they shall, and they twain shall be one flesh. Wherefore they are no more twain, but one flesh.
One flesh. One flesh.
What therefore God has joined together, let not man put asunder.
So, Jesus, this is the beginning. Bible does this a lot too. I guess it's kind of like what Jesus said about paraphrasing. The Bible doesn't put everything right out in your face. You have to do some studying and research to actually find out certain things. But the Bible, through Jesus, talking, being tempted with the Pharisees, if I can put it in modern day language, paraphrasing, Jesus said, why are you going to ask me about divorce when you have no idea what marriage is all about? Can anybody get that out of that?
Mm-hmm.
He said, why do you ask me about divorce when you have no idea what marriage is all about? So then he directs them back to what marriage is all about. He takes them back where? Takes them back to the beginning and says what? They were made male and female. How many times have we heard that used in different contexts? When the Bible tells you it's referring to marriage. So he made them male and female. While we're at there, let me kind of point out a point at that. We're going to go to that scripture, but I want you to get this in your head now. It says, and in there. Male and female. Anytime you're doing anything and you're making something, you put the conjunction and in there. That means you have to have both sides of the and to achieve the objective. If an or was in there, you only need one side of the or to achieve the objective. Simplify, making a cake. If I'm gonna make a cake and it calls for flour and sugar, my cake is not gonna complete if I just put flour in there, right?
Right.
I've gotta have the flour and the sugar. Mm-hmm. So we gotta get that down. We gotta understand that.
Amen.
Because we're gonna go there. But like I say, anytime the Bible puts something twice in there, and he has it twice, actually has it a few more times in a different little concept, but to be more specific, he has it twice in that. Let's go to Mark 1, Mark 10 1. We're doing a little review. Let's get us back into the definitions of what marriage is all about, understanding of what marriage is all about. Not just the original intent, because God never changes. It says it's intent right now as it is then. So we're going to Mark. Mark 10:1.
And he arose from thence and cometh into the coast of Judea by the farther side of Jordan. People resort unto him again. And as he was wont, he taught them again. And the Pharisees came to him and asked him, is it lawful for a man to put away his wife, tempting him? And he answered and said unto them, what did Moses command you? And they said, Moses suffered to write a bill of divorcement and to put her away. And Jesus answered and said unto him, for the hardness of your heart he wrote you this precept. But from the beginning of the creation God made them male and female. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife. And they twain shall be one flesh. So then they are no more twain, but one flesh. What therefore God hath joined together, let not man put asunder.
Amen. Man, I feel so honored. I got the pastor reading for me.
Amen.
Hey, I tell y'all, watch out, man. I might start running in here. That's a real spiritual thing. Y'all don't understand.
Yeah, it's true.
Y'all were saying I'm just fascinated.
All right. He added one extra thing in this one that's very important. The hardness of your heart. We're going to get into that. Write that down, because when we get into our further classes about relationships, we're going to get into that. Underline that, the hardness of your heart. But right now we want to do a little review going back. So Jesus once again told them, if I can paraphrase again, why are you going to ask me about divorce when you have no idea what marriage is all about? So it's Jesus that directed us. Now, how many of us, we really listen to what Jesus got to say, you know? So it's Jesus directing us back to the beginning. Let's go to Genesis 1:26. Back to the beginning to get an understanding of what marriage is all about. So he said about the male and the female. He kind of broke it up. He didn't put it all together. Excuse me, you all. Kind of broke it up.
Genesis what?
1:26. Genesis 1:26. We're going to nip this right in the bud here. Everybody there?
Amen.
Then God said, let us make man in our own image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish and over the sea, over the birds, over the air, and over the cattle, over all the earth, and every creeping thing that creepeth on the earth. So God created man. Created man. Oh, here it come, y'all. Created man in his own image. Understanding now, first there was Adam, right? Mm-hmm. So he's giving you the beginning. First he created man, Adam man, and who Adam was. And we're going to get into that when we start dealing with his relationship. So he's giving you, first he created Adam. Adam was man, but we're going to find out that Adam and Eve was called man also. But we'll get into that, find that out later. So he created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him male and female. All right, this is the marriage part that Jesus was talking about. First he created Adam. Then out of Adam, he created Eve. He consecrated this thing called the marriage, male and female. When he created male and female, this is when he developed the marriage. So no longer is Adam himself is in the image and likeness of God. Now it takes what? Eve. So we're saying what? Male and female. Isn't that what Jesus said? Then he know, talking about marriage itself, not about the creation of man himself, but talking about marriage himself, itself. He created him male and female. So he created Eve. Now it takes Eve and Adam to reflect this image and likeness of God. Adam can't do it alone. Eve can't do it alone. So anytime you see somebody or a little kid, I kind of joke about this, ask you what God looks like. All you have to do is grab your married couple, stand them upside and say, that's what God looks like. God looks like married people that are saved. We're going to find out too. That are saved. Unsaved? No. So in Genesis 1, we find out through 26 through 27, 28 also, we find out that God created the marriage, institute this marriage, give them the power over all of the earth, and it was male and female. So male and female has to come to some, has to be in some kind of order. Mm-hmm. Male and female has to reflect some kind of order. Mm-hmm. Let's go back to the very, very, very beginning. Well, let's go back to Genesis 1:26. In 1:26, it says, then God said, let who?
Us.
So the order is already there in the image, right? He said, let us. What's the us he's talking about? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So the order is already created. So the marriage is reflecting the order of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We can go and get into that if we get into Ephesians when it says that God is the head of Jesus and Jesus is the head. How do you go? Wait, I'm paraphrasing. God is the head of the man's head of the woman, to paraphrase, go. We get into that. Didn't get into the church part of it, but there's a section in Ephesians, I think it's Ephesians where it says, help me out, Pastor. Is it Ephesians 6? But it reflects this order. Ephesians 6. You got it? Well, I think they kind of look up, but the order is already there. in that we're creating the image and likeness of God. We're creating the image and likeness of the order of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. We created the image and likeness through, you have it?
For the husband is the head of the wife, he testified, as also Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Therefore, just as the church is subject to Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands and everything. Is
that the that's one? That's not the one. That's, must not be Ephesians. It says,
later, further on in Ephesians, it says, well, this is talking about, as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. I don't know if that's what you're wanting.
No, it's one that says that God be the head of Christ, as Christ is the head of the man, and man is the head of the woman.
Head of the wife.
Yeah. But anyway, I got it written down when I get it.
That's 23. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he's the Savior of the body.
Yeah, that's what
he
just read.
He just read, yeah.
Oh, yeah, but there's another one that you want.
Yeah, I get it. I got it written down when I get to the relationships. But anyway, it creates that order. So the marriage is an order reflecting the same order as the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. So in order to reflect that order, you have to come about. You have to be saved. So that's how we came about with the definition of marriage. Marriage meaning that is what? It's male and female. And it says male and female for a specific reason, because you can only be born male and female. You can't grow up and become male and female. You can only be born male and female. And male and female coming together creates the image and likeness of God. It didn't say man and woman. It said male and female. Because I can become a woman, and then I can become a woman right now. I can put on some long hair, put on a dress, and I'll be a woman. And a woman can become a man. It's an attitude. Men and women is an attitude. Male and female is a birthright. You can only be born that way. So, definition of marriage is what?
Male and female together to reflect the image and likeness of God.
Everybody got that definition? Because that's our foundation.
Got it.
Next definition we're going to get into is love. Anybody got a definition of love? Love is the Spirit of God. That sounds good. I heard you say God has an order to create a relationship with man. Let me write that down. That's preachable right there. And he does. That is very appreciative. Write that down. God has an order to create a relationship with man. Because we're going to get into a relationship. That's good. Something we can study and work on. But let's go first to Deuteronomy 6:5. So we're going to kind of attack that. And this is our foundation. I kind of got checked on this, but I'm a.
You said Deuteronomy
6:5.
6:5.
I'm gonna kind of stand on this, even though it's a little Old Testament. Pastor Shields kind of gave me a little New Testament correction on it, but it is this. Everybody there?
Yes.
You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. So the question is, if you're giving it all to God, and how do you give it all to God? What are you giving to your mate? And how do you give to your mate? If you're giving it all to God, this is what love is all about. Because it has to start here. You have to give it all to God. Problem with, I was trying to step in here right now. Problem with a lot of relationships, we put people in our heart where only God should be. Mm. We got people standing in a position where only God should be. So we get discouraged, we get hurt because we got our expectations that should be on God, on people. Pastor Shields, Scales said it something like this, saying that we should be in Christ. Mm-hmm. But it's kind of saying the same thing in a little bit more detail here, same thing, because if you're in Christ, you acting out of His love, and your love is directed towards God first, yourself, then people, being mm-hmm. in Christ. Mm-hmm. To be in Christ, to be able to make that effort to step in Christ, you got to have the love of God to actually get in Christ. Mm-hmm. Understanding that He did love you first. Mm-hmm. But in that, you got to give it all to Him, because God has a commandment. That's all got to come to Him first. Mm-hmm. Then after coming to Him, then you're able to love yourself and love people. So the problem is, we don't understand what love is. We don't understand who love is and how we're supposed to express love. Mm-hmm. So the first step in understanding love, when we got to love, is understanding that we've got to give it all to God first. Mm-hmm. Second step in love is understanding who love is. And who is love? God. So God is love. Anybody got the scripture where it says God is love? First John 3. Let's go
there. All right, First John 4.
First John 4.
Mm-hmm. God is love. Okay, and we have known 4:16. We have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him.
Everybody hear that? Mm-hmm. So we know that God is love. So the first thing we know that we have to love God first, know that God is love. And then what we need to know, we need to understand, it's part of the rebirth process, that love has been given to us.
Shed abroad, yes.
That we've been given a spirit of love. Awesome. Mm-hmm. Anybody quote that for me?
Yeah, herein you know we that we dwell in Him. Spirit, then we have the Romans,
Romans 5.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Sure. Okay. Okay. Hope maketh not. Romans 5:5. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us.
So this is the whole rebirth process again, where we have to be born again. But that love has to be, that heart, that spirit has to be put in us. Once we receive that spirit, we take that spirit, we give it all back to God. And once we give it all back to God, in that process, He teaches us what? Through the renewing of our mind, through the word, how to love ourselves, through the renewing of that word, and how to love others. But first of all, it's got to be given all back to God. That's love. Love is a spirit. Love is God. Love is not some emotion. Love is not a feeling, like the world tried to tell you. Love is not these earthly things. What are some of the little quotes they say what love is? Ain't got no money, don't get no honey, that type of love. Love is not sex. Love is not sex. We got the soul hung up into, and a lot of these little young, which has young people, I tell them in the middle, a lot of these little young kids get so hung up, and these boys quote that, if you don't love me, you're supposed to give it up, you know, that type of thing. Love is not sex. Real love, my daughter asked me before she got married, how would I know when I really love this guy? I said, when you have a sense of emotion in you where you care more about his relationship with God than your own, that he has to be right with God, then you know you love him. The rest is just lust. Mm-hmm. You got attraction, that's just lust. That's not love. Because in love, the most fulfilling thing is not sex, it's intimacy. And we're going to get into that when we get into relationship. What is intimacy? How do we establish intimacy? You learn how to have intimacy with God first, through that love. So the second part of this, we learned that God is love. Learn what marriage is. We learn what love is. God is love. Love is a spirit. And love is something that is given to us, a spirit that is given to us. Not emotion. It's not a feeling. It's not sex. It's not all these other things that the world try to put on us. Next thing is what? Covenant. Anybody want to explain to me what covenant is?
The definition of covenant, God's commitment to create a relationship with man, or you want the agreement or contract form between two parties, defining the limits and boundaries of a relationship, all kinds of us.
Basically, that's it in the totality. Let me ask you this before I give you, ask you all that. Come on, it's more than just the pastors here that's been here before. Y'all, some of y'all should be answering these questions. Don't let them just take over now. But anyway. Let me ask you this. Can you have a covenant between two men or man and a business?
Yeah.
Can you?
It's a contract.
Is a contract a covenant?
A covenant is an agreement or a contract.
Covenant is an agreement or a contract. Somebody better come on. He wasn't here last year, was he? Come on. Talk to me, y'all. Is a covenant, agreement, or a contract? Can a contract be broken?
Yes.
Yeah.
Can an agreement be broken?
Yes.
Can a covenant be broken? No. So a covenant can't be a contract or agreement because a covenant can't be broken. Everybody got quiet. So what is a covenant? If it's not a contract, it's not an agreement, what is a covenant? Come on, y'all. Y'all don't have your notes? Go ahead.
Unbreakable bond between God and man.
Unbreakable bond between God and man. So I have a wife. She got my back. Come on, baby. A covenant is an unbreakable bond between God and man. Now, this plays in, I tell you, with love, you have to give it all to God first. It's the same. What love's got to do with? It's got to do everything with everything. Because it all points back to God. Because a marriage is a covenant. We When you go to say your marriage vows, you're not, this world has messed this up so tough. When you go say your marriage vows, you're not saying your marriage vows to your partner, to your spouse or future spouse. You're saying your marriage vows to God to create that covenant. That covenant is between you and God. How you do things, how you respond, how you act in that marriage is not has anything to do with your spouse. It's between you and God. That's why the responsibility on how you act, and you will be judged. But when you stand before God, you can't do like Adam and say, that woman, it ain't gonna work. I don't care how far off your mate might go. You gotta stay in line. Your efforts is to stay in line with the word, with God's word. And in doing that, you can pull your spouse back. We're going to get into that relationship.
Brother Michael.
Yes.
Question.
Yes.
Do you think that a lot of Christians don't really understand the meaning of the covenant, unbreakable bond between God and men? Christians, I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. Because the divorce rate among Christians is like 50% plus.
52.
Yeah. I said 50% plus. Yeah.
No, they don't, because it's a whole, and I have to put it this way, we have been slightly deceived as Christians through this European perspective of what Christianity is all about. You can go to a Middle Eastern and say covenant, whether he's Christian or not, they know what covenant is. But covenant is not something that's taught in the Western genre. The unbreakable part of it. We grasp it through the Bible, but we don't get it through our environment. Middle Easterns get it through their environment, through their society. We don't get that through our society. We get, you can change your mind. Somebody the other day said, oh, that was my wife. So, you're a woman, you can change your mind anytime you get rid. Woman or not, anybody can change their mind. Yes. And it seems to be done a lot in this building. We break bonds, we break agreements. Anytime we get ready, we don't want to go through the the sacrifice to stand on our word on anything. So no, you're right, Ms. Hill. In this society, we really don't understand what our covenant is all about. But that's why we're here. That's why part of why we gave it. You want to say that again, Denise? What is the covenant?
Unbreakable bond between God and man.
So we got to understand that this is not between man and man. A covenant cannot be between man and man. A covenant is between God and man. But I will. We're going to get into covenants here. When we get in, we're going to show that there is a covenant that men tried to initiate between man and man, but that's not a true covenant, even though the Bible called it a covenant. And the one prophet or king that tried to do it got into big trouble. Got into big trouble with God when he tried to do it with an unholy nation. So we'll get into that. But the foundation of covenant, which you have to understand, once again, it points back to God. It's between God and man, between you as an individual and God. Not between you and your spouse, not between you and you'll go down to the court and do that thing. It's not between you and the city. This is between you and God. That's why was it Matthew and Mark? He mentioned that they become one flesh. That's the organization of it. Become one flesh. Think of that literally. Now you want to get a divorce. What's going to happen if you're one flesh? Can you divide yourself? But God has put together that no man. Can you divide yourself? You can't. Something is going to die. You see that so much in divorces. People are dying. They may be walking around, but they're dead inside. they're gonna go in, oh, they generally, I say they go in one ditch or they're gonna go in one ditch, where they're not gonna become totally useless to any and everybody. And then we're gonna get into this other ditch where they become so self-centered, they're still gonna be useless to any and everybody, but they're gonna be doing any and everything, trying to revise themselves, if I can put it that way, trying to medicate the pain. Because death hurts. Death is very painful. Death without God, death period, is very painful. We can't imagine how painful it is because we haven't gone through it, but Jesus knew. He had to go through it. He was so agonizing about it. He was sweating blood. I said, we will never really fully understand what Jesus went through for us. We can try to imagine it, but I don't think we will ever fully understand until we get there and really talk with him and be put in that spirit totally, and that having our bodies and our minds being renewed, mm-hmm. and being up in heaven to understand what Jesus, or to sense what Jesus went through by going through death. Mm-hmm. But death is very painful. But we got a Savior.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
We're not going through death. We got a Savior. He died for us. He took all that on. He went through all that for us. So, the three things that I really wanted to review and understand: marriage. Get this definition down. Male and female come together to create the image of God. Love. A spirit. And is God. Covenant. Unbreakable bond between man and God. Everybody got that?
Got it.
You got to stand on that, because as we go further, it's going to get a little... And I got a book I would like for everybody to read, too, because this will really help you out. Joyce Meyer has a book out called Battlefield of the Mind. Yeah, this book, as far as if you get into something that's in the Word and it really creates a turmoil in yourself, it's because that word is breaking down some bonds that are in you, in your mind, in your flesh. And sometimes it becomes very difficult to handle that, because the battlefield is in our head. Tearing down these old ways of thinking, tearing down this dumb stuff we've been given. Renewing our minds is a battle. It's not dealing with everything out there, because we've been given power over serpents. We've been given power over everything out there. But we don't know it. But that's not where the battle is. The battle is in your mind. Once you get your mind straight, nothing out there can affect you. I was talking to, I think it was my son or my daughter the other day, that to dislike, to hurt, to get angry is a decision. You hear me?
Yeah.
To dislike, to hurt, to get angry is a decision. Mm. Yeah. Your decision. Mm. You decide to incorporate those feelings. You decide. But if you don't have the power and the ability to control your mind to do it, you let it just come in. And sometimes you get off and it becomes a thing, like some people like to get off and argue with. Do this because they got so used to it. Used to what? Giving in. Not taking control. Kind of like what I tell my young people. Get out of that chicken coop. Get up in the air and soar like the eagle you're supposed to be. We're so busy down there in that chicken coop dealing with all the stuff on the ground, we don't realize the power we got in us to rise above all that. But all that is a decision. Anybody is a decision. And if you like me and you hate to be controlled, you ain't controlling me. I'm sorry. I don't know, some God put in me a long time ago. A Pepsi ain't controlling me. If I get to where I'm drinking too many Pepsi, putting it down, you ain't controlling me. I got to something in me that triggers when something look like it's time to take control, and I just like, oh, bag up time. If you come at me with an attitude like you're going to control me, you better bag up, because I'm going this way. I'm going to let you say your words, and I'm going to walk away like ain't nothing even happened. I said control. I didn't say submit. I don't get into that. It's a whole different ball game. Because submission is what? A decision. And once you make the decision to submit unto, submit up under, it's almost like a covenant. You shouldn't break it. It's unbreakable. But I'll take talking to the person that you have or the organization that you have submitted to. You can be released from submission. But it's just one step down from a covenant. And in a covenant, in a marriage, is submission. But we made it a bad name. We're going to get into that, get into relationships. We turn submission into a bad name. Any questions? Like I said, we're going to cut this one a little short. Any questions?
Yes.
Whoa.
Can one submit without being submissive?
No. Oh, if you talk about an attitude of somebody who just gives in to everything.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking of, an attitude.
Yeah.
What I was thinking of, a person can submit. If you gave me a directive to do something, I could do it, but my attitude could not be like, I'm just doing this because he asked me to do it.
Nah.
But I wouldn't be my care that I wouldn't be. What am I trying to say?
I know what you're trying to say.
Oh, okay.
You can one submit and not agree.
Yeah.
There
yeah.
you go.
Right. That's it.
Yes, because submission has nothing to do with agreement.
Right. Exactly.
Submission is a placing yourself on authority. Sticking to your word.
Yeah, that's it. That's what I'm saying. You can do it.
You don't have to agree with somebody to submit to them. It's understanding and respecting that order.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to get into that in the relationship, and particularly in the marriage relationship. We're going to get into this submission thing and understand that submission, the whole thing. What is this all about? Love. What love's got to do with everything we do here? It's not because somebody's going to beat you over the head and make you do it. Even God doesn't beat you over your head and make you saved. It's a decision you're going to have to make by understanding the love that he has placed on you, the knocking on the door of your heart that he has done and shown himself to you. But he's not going to hit you over the head and make you. But marriage is the same thing. You cannot make nobody do anything. You have to pray for them to grow in that, to see that, to understand that. But if your heart is in the wrong place, you're going to make the wrong decision to try to make them because you're hurting in a way you shouldn't be hurting. I won't say you don't hurt, but you're hurting in a way that you shouldn't be hurting. It hurts me to see the unsaved. I'm not going to get a baseball bat and go knock every unsaved person in the head and say, get your stuff right. You know? It hurts me to see people that are hurting. But I can't make them come to God. I only can give them the word and pray for them and have the Holy Spirit to influence them and open up their eyes to take these blinders off so they can see. So it doesn't mean because you're in God, you've given it all to God, that you won't feel hurt, but you won't feel hurt to a point where it's going to make you react in a negative way. You won't feel hurt to a point where you become useless. You won't feel hurt to a point where you want to hurt others. The hurt you feel when you feel when you're in Christ, the hurt you feel when you feel in love builds up compassion. That's why when Jesus saw people that were sick, compassion rose up in him. It's a hurt. It's a pain. But it generates compassion to want to save them, to want to heal them, to want to make it better. So if I can leave you with that for tonight, in dealing with marriage, understanding that marriage is a reflection of God. Understanding that love is a reflection of God. Understanding that covenant is a reflection of that whole order of God. If we can grasp and stand on that and step forward, we can help multitudes of people around us, starting with our spouses, starting with those that we come in contact with, if you're not married, or starting with those that you may be getting married to. But first of all, we have to start with ourselves. We have to renew our mind. We have to, I can go ahead and say this, de-harden our heart. We've got to get a heart of flesh instead of a heart of stone, because a heart of stone leads to divorce. A heart of flesh leads to compassion, to love, togetherness, to want to grasp long-suffering. So with that, we will kick off next week with taking it marriage. And I want to give a handout real quick before I allow Denise to come up here. You know how to give it out already? You know how to give out
marriage?
Okay. Focus on that. This sounds a little redundant. Focus on that handout I gave you. Look at marriage and then look at it from the point of view of those different areas I gave. Look at love and then look at it from the point of view of those different areas I gave. Look at covenant and look at it from the point of view. But next week we're just going to work on, for the next 2 weeks we're going to just work on marriage. Marriage relationship in the Bible. Can I kick this out? Because I just discovered something. And then just kind of just wiggled my little head. And I'm like, you go, God. You know there's only one married couple in the faith Hall of Fame?
Who is it?
Tell me who it is, Pastor. There's one only married. One married couple mentioned in the Faith Hall of Fame. I went, glory to God. What? Check it out. It's going to be Abraham and Sarah. They're the only married couple mentioned in Hebrews. Everybody else is mentioned as an individual. Even though Noah was married, didn't mention nothing about his wife, just said he saved his family. But Sarah was mentioned by name. Abraham was mentioned by name. There's no other married couple mentioned by name than Hebrews in the faith. And we're going to get into that. Because that just plays into what we're going to talk about next week. And then I just kind of like, I had to say that because it made the hair on my neck stand up when I read it. The Lord showed me that there's only one married couple. And so what does that tell us? If they're in there, there's a lot about marriage that we can glean from their relationship. There's a lot about marriage that we can glean from their relationship. And we're going to get into it. But right now, before I use up all the time, I've got to give Denise. I don't have to give, but I love to give. Denise, a little period to kind of minister to you all.
I don't have too much today this time, but I was going through my notes and I ran across this little story that I thought would be very appropriate that you all need to hear. I might have did it before, might have spoke about it before, but it's called The Marriage Box. And it says, most people get married believing a myth that marriage is a beautiful box full of all the things they have longed for. And first of all, it is companionship, intimacy, friendship, and more. But the truth is that marriage, at the start, is an empty box. You must put something into it before you can take anything out. There is no love in the empty box, in marriage. And the love is in people. So remember, there is no love in marriage. Marriage is in the people. And the people put love in marriage. There is no romance in marriage. You have to infuse that into your marriage. A couple must learn the art and the form and form the habit of giving, loving, serving, praising, to keep the box full. If you take out more than you put in, the box will be empty.
That's good.
Wow. Good thought.
Good thoughts.
So that goes back to our expectations. You know, if you expect too much and you've never put anything into the box, you're always expecting someone to give to you and you're not giving. You know, that will make your box empty. So in a marriage, the process and the principle should be always about giving. Because we're reflecting the image of God, right? God is a giver. So we should always be giving. And so if each person is giving, you're receiving as well. If I'm giving and then he's giving back, then I'm receiving. So that makes our box full. But in the marriage itself, it starts out empty.
Wow.
Something to think about.
I've got to call that, which y'all know, that's called Denise's Corner. stay tuned next week for Denise's Corner.
Just want to remind everybody to set your clocks up.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. All right, next week, we cut this a little short. Tell your friends, tell everybody, next week we're going to get started in earnest. Next week, what love's got to do with it? Marriage class about relationship. We're going to put this into perspective in terms of relationship. We got the meanings. We dealt with two classes on the meanings, on building this foundation of what marriage is all about. We understand that none of this is coming out of my head. We understand that God himself, Jesus himself, has made the directive of what marriage really is all about, what marriage is. And we just got to build from it. Now, I know you're going to get out there, because I'll turn on the TV and I hear some of these preachers and we from big ministers, we've heard a lot of off-the-wall stuff. When you understand this, it's going to be a little off-the-wall about what marriage is. Mm-hmm. Now that you all know, don't accept a lot of that stuff. Understand they're trying to motivate their people. But the reality of it is that what marriage is really all about, to get a true understanding of this, we went to the Bible. We've got it. We got it. So we're going to stand on it and we're going to develop from it.
Father, we thank you for the Word of God. Thank you, God, for the plan that you have for our lives in terms of marriage. And all of the Word that we receive tonight that illustrates the need, demonstrates the love that God had for us, and we ought to love one another even as the Lord loved us, God loved us. Father, help us to get a revelation of what it means to love one another and love our spouses. And Father, help us to articulate and communicate this revelation and take it far and near to those that have the need for it. Father, we thank you, God, for the Word of God, because we know the Word of God never returns void. It will always accomplish its purpose, and it will always prosper in the thing whereunto it is sent. Father, we thank you that through meditating and speaking these truths to ourselves and getting thoroughly established in the Word of righteousness and all the things that you have revealed to us will enable us to become very fruitful and profitable and be full of love and the fullness of God. Father, we know that love is the key, and you mentioned that we need to be rooted and grounded in love. And love is not just a feeling, but love is in deed and in truth.
Yes.
And Father, we thank you for all that you have revealed to us and made known through the word tonight. And we give you praise, and we pray that you will give us the zeal and the fervor and the determination to see others receiving the same light, because you said the interest of your word giveth light, giveth understanding to the simple. And Father, we thank you that we're instruments in your hands and your channels for you to work through. And Father, tonight we give you praise and glory for all that shall be done and manifested through this course of study. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.